Some of you may have heard the word Pineapple Express. So Pineapple Express is actually a type of atmospheric river. How come I've just started hearing about atmospheric rivers? They're natural phenomenon. They've always existed. There was about 84% of flood damages were caused by atmospheric rivers. So the projections are indicating that the most extreme atmospheric rivers have the potential to become a lot more extreme. And this has to do with the ability for the atmospheric rivers to hold more moisture. I'm actually going to start with a video about atmospheric rivers. They say a picture says 1,000 words, so a short video says 1,000,000, maybe? So let's start with that.
Imagine a river in the sky with more than twice the water of the Amazon. It's called an atmospheric river. Atmospheric rivers are long, narrow bands of concentrated water vapor that produce major amounts of rainfall. Atmospheric rivers begin in the warm waters of the Pacific, where water evaporates into the air. When this humid air meets a Pacific storm, the water vapor is concentrated and driven toward the coast, becoming a fire hose of rainfall and wind. Once the atmospheric river reaches the coastal mountains and the inland Sierra, the collision squeezes additional rain and snow from the system. Atmospheric rivers are responsible for up to half of California's annual precipitation. Scientists at Scripps Institution of Oceanography have developed a new system that rates atmospheric rivers on a scale from 1 to 5. The rating system helps identify atmospheric rivers that are beneficial, such as those that replenish reservoirs, and ones that produce hazards like flooding. Understanding atmospheric rivers is key to improving weather forecasts for better managing water resources and predicting flood risk.
As Harry said, I'll be talking more about atmospheric rivers and going into a lot more detail than that video. And I just want to acknowledge that I am presenting on behalf of the whole center. So there was a ton of work that I'm showing that are various different researchers throughout the center that have done. And in particular, I'd like to call out Deanna Nash, who helped quite a bit with this presentation. So atmospheric rivers, here's a satellite image of what we call precipitable water, so the water in the atmosphere. And the atmospheric rivers have specific characteristics. So one is a length and width. So the length, they're long and narrow. So the length is usually at least 2 times the width. And then there's components of it that is how we measure it. So the components are the transport or the winds and the water vapor. So this transport and winds, we often refer to atmospheric rivers or the measurement of atmospheric rivers as called integrated water vapor transport or IVT. And that's a combination of the winds and the total amount of water in the atmosphere. I say the total amount of water in the atmosphere, but actually atmospheric rivers are generally much lower in the atmosphere. They're below the, generally speaking, the 10,000 feet and lower. So they come kind of relatively close to the surface of the Earth. And atmospheric rivers are global phenomenon. So if you look at this map, all of these different red dots are indicating places where atmospheric rivers make landfall. So you can see they're all over the world. And the size of the dot is an indication of the average annual frequency that atmospheric rivers make landfall along the coast. And you can see our coastline along here stands out. They are generally subtropical. So if you look in the tropical range around the equator from 20 north to 20 south, there's less of them. And they extend farther into the subtropics and the polar regions. One question I had is how come I've just started hearing about atmospheric rivers? And as this map suggests in some of the videos, they're natural phenomenon. They've always existed, but the term hadn't been coined really in the scientific literature until 1997, 1999, depending who you ask. And there's other features in the atmosphere that are similar related to atmospheric rivers. And so the scientific community went back and forth on kind of what to call them and how to define them. And it's been really recently within the last 10 years that the term has been, I'd say, more broadly accepted within the scientific community. And then there's been more additional outreach to media, broadcast Mets, to talk about this storm type. And some of you may have heard the word Pineapple Express. So Pineapple Express is actually a type of atmospheric river. So the name came from, because it's atmospheric river that generally comes, actually I'll go back a couple slides. It's like this one, where it generally comes from Hawaii, and that orientation to California is relatively impactful for our state. And so that's where the term Pineapple Express came from, was this type of atmospheric river that started in the region of Hawaii. The other thing, there's a sharp seasonality to atmospheric rivers. And so if you look here, there's a map along the U.S. West Coast. And this is Southern California, Northern California, going along to Oregon, Washington, British Columbia, Southeast Alaska, and Southwest Alaska. And as you can see, if we're going to start kind of in the spring, summer in Alaska, and then it comes down along the coast. And so that seasonality doesn't mean that we don't get atmospheric rivers any other time of the year, but that's really where we get the biggest atmospheric rivers, and they're most impactful and the most frequent atmospheric rivers. The next one is, this is important for thinking about what the video was talking about in terms of the skill or atmospheric rivers and improving water management or emergency management. So what this graphic is showing is the predictability of atmospheric rivers relative to precipitation using that term I said before, IVT, the integrated water vapor transport, so the combination of the winds and the water vapor. And if you look, this is the forecast day. And so this is 24 hours ahead, 48 hours, 72, and you could go up. And the improved forecast skill goes up. So the higher the number, the better the forecast skill. And as you expect, you know, at day one, you have a great forecast skill. And then as you go out in time, the forecast skill drops off. And this black line is looking at IVT and atmospheric rivers, whereas this gray line is looking at precipitation. And so there's actually more skill in looking at forecast of atmospheric rivers. And so this is especially noticeable at what we consider some of the longer lead times in the weather forecasting, kind of five to 7 days, where there's this indication that there's going to be potentially a storm coming. The shift in, you know, where exactly it may make landfall and how much precipitation is kind of rained out of that atmospheric river may vary a bit, but it's a good situational awareness to know that there's something might be coming towards you and impacting your region. And so this is just another way of showing the same result. And so this is by year, starting in 1984, and this is for day seven, so a week out, what the forecast would be. And you can see the skill, similarly, the improved forecast skill goes up, and the black line is IVT, or atmospheric rivers, and it's always higher than precipitation. And so we use this in a lot of what we talk about in terms of forecast skill and forecast awareness, providing forecast for atmospheric rivers, which I'll talk about a little bit later on. So many of you know this. You live in San Diego, I assume. But our precipitation, so rainfall here, we don't get snowfall, but when I say precipitation, I mean both rainfall and snowfall, is highly variable, right? It goes up and down. So we have this high variability. And we've actually looked at this, and this really jumps out. So this is a map, obviously, of the U.S. And if you look, California really jumps out. And then Southern California, even more so than the rest of California. And what each of these dots represent is a weather station that measures precipitation. And the coloring of the dot represents what we call the coefficient of variation. So it's how much it varies from year to year. And so if you look here, in Southern California, when it's this 4 to 5, our precipitation, about half of it can vary from year to year. So that's pretty extreme. And this is something, you know, California is relatively unique in terms of that variability. So not knowing year to year how much rain we're going to get or how much precipitation we're going to get can be, as you can imagine, a water management challenge. For emergency management, it could be another challenge. And so this is one of the things at the center we've been really focusing on, is how do we improve those forecasts of atmospheric rivers at all sorts of different timescales to help with that awareness. I think this is a pretty cool figure. This is something that it's showing the number of days to generally get that it takes to get half the precipitation. And so if you look here, again, California stands out a little less so. Some of the monsoons areas stand out as well. But in general, it's about 5 to 10 days throughout much of California, you know, 10 to 15 in the northern parts where it's wetter, to get about half the precipitation. So it doesn't take much. And what that means is it's generally the really big storms that matter a lot for whether or not it's going to be a dry or wet year. And if we look at what most of those storms are, they're atmospheric rivers. And so what this is showing is this is the percent contribution of atmospheric rivers to total annual average precipitation. And if you look along this kind of Russian River area or Northern California is kind of the bullseye, where it's upwards of, you know, 50%. Down here, it's, you know, it's close to 40 to 50%. And as you move inland, that starts to decrease. So as the atmospheric river comes across the ocean, like the video showed, and intersects with our topography, we start to see a lot of precipitation. And so those atmospheric rivers are really important. The flip side of that, as indicated, they can also be relatively impactful. And so this is just showing the post-fire debris flow, the Montecito in 2018, which was caused, it was on the back end of an atmospheric river, something called a narrow cold frontal rain band, where you have really intense precipitation, not necessarily long periods of time, which can lead to these post-fire debris flows. And then this was a study done by a colleague that looked at the damages from flood insurance throughout the West, and this is the percentage or fraction of damages that were due to atmospheric rivers. And as you can see in California, you know, upwards of almost 90% in most places, and overall throughout the Western U.S., it was about 84% of flood damages were caused by atmospheric rivers. So, and the reason why atmospheric rivers are so impactful, right? And we, again, this is something that the video showed, but you see these atmospheric rivers that they come across the ocean, and the wind, right? It's a combination of that moisture and the wind, and then when it intersects with our topography and our mountains, it goes up and produces the precipitation. And then this is the idea of the rain shadow on the desert on the other side. So it doesn't necessarily always make it over to the mountains. And then that's where you get the deserts. And so this is, if you think about, so one thing that's really cool about San Diego is in terms of, you know, from coast to mountain to desert, we're one of the most biodiverse counties, in part because of our topography and how the precipitation comes in along the coast and the mountains, and then we get all the way to the deserts. And so this feature here that, you know, happens along our coast and with the Sierras and inland, it also happens here more specifically in San Diego too. And so this is looking at that atmospheric river scale that was mentioned. It's similar to the idea of a hurricane scale, but there are some differences I will cover. And it goes from an AR, which is atmospheric river 1, all the way through an AR 5. And generally what we think about is atmospheric rivers 1 and 2 are relatively beneficial. Atmospheric river 3 can be potentially beneficial or hazardous. And then atmospheric rivers 4 and 5 are generally more hazardous conditions. And so this is based on two different criteria. One is the maximum strength of the atmospheric river, which you see here. This is, again, this IVT. What I mentioned is that combination of the winds and the precipitation. And then the other one is the duration, right? If you have something that comes through relatively quickly, it's generally not as impactful as something that lingers and stays for a long time. And so you can get various different combinations depending on, you know, if it lasted for about 2 days and was moderate, it could be somewhere between this AR2 or AR3 if it was 2 to 3 days. And so that's how you can look at the scale, is thinking about it. One thing that's really unique about the atmospheric river scale, and is different than, say, the hurricane scale, is it's location dependent. And so this was from a forecast this year, and this is a map, and each one of these dots represent the AR scale at that specific location. Right? And so if you're looking at this map, what you see along Oregon, most of it was an AR3, but if you come down into California, it was an AR1, and then other parts, you know, Southern California didn't have any impact, so it wasn't an AR, and that's why you're seeing the white dots. And the reason for this is if you think about it, right, the atmospheric river in these areas where it's an AR3 are most likely to be more impactful and potentially more hazardous because it's both stronger and or longer in duration. Whereas if you go farther south where it's shorter and not as strong, those impacts aren't likely to be as strong. And so that's one thing I think that at times can confuse people, because you're used to thinking like a hurricane has a number associated with it, where the atmospheric river scale for your location, it does, but it can change depending on your location. And there was a study that was done that actually looked at the atmospheric river scale and with the National Weather Service warning watches and advisories. And so one of the things you're seeing here is the correlation between the atmospheric river scale and when these warning watches or advisories were issued. And there's relatively strong correlation throughout much of the West between the scale and these advisories. So this just links even more so the importance of the atmospheric rivers and the scale to these potential impacts. The other thing that we looked at was the flood insurance cost by scale. And so what you can see here is that it actually scales, the flood insurance costs scale by AR scale as well. And one of the things, as you can see, some of these are looking at the outliers here, you know, sometimes you can have an AR1 that has, that is really impactful. Oftentimes what's associated with that is that that's an atmospheric river one that comes on the back of a sequence of atmospheric rivers. And so it's when the, you know, reservoirs are already full, soils are already saturated, those sorts of conditions which are more likely to lead to flood damages than, you know, an AR1 in November when the soils are still dry, for example. So what about atmospheric rivers in the future? So this is, I think, a nice summary, and I'll dig into it a little bit more about what do we know about atmospheric rivers in the future. The frequency is likely to increase in terms of flooding, in part because atmospheric rivers are generally warmer storms. They're bringing in kind of warm tropical water over, and so it can actually lead to more snow melt. And so rain on snow is something you might have heard of, and so that can potentially lead to more melt. Also, in generally just warmer temperatures, there's more snow and ice melt. Atmospheric rivers, the other thing that we know is, you know, just in general with global warming, the atmosphere can hold more moisture. And so if the atmospheric river has more moisture in it, there's more moisture for it to potentially rain out. And so this is one of the reasons that atmospheric rivers are projected to become stronger in the future, is that the ability to hold more moisture. And so if we look here now, this is a study that was comparing a future period at the end of the century compared to a historical period. And so what this is showing is the percent change and how much more atmospheric rivers contribute to precipitation. And so similar to before, you know, along the coast, we see higher percentages around 20% to 25%. And as you move inland, that starts to decrease a little bit. But what this is showing is that atmospheric rivers are going to become increasingly important to our overall precipitation regime. The other part of it is looking at extremes. And so this is just a case looking at the Russian River. And this is the daily precipitation percentile. So greater than 99th percentile are the really, really big events. You know, 50 to 60 is kind of the median, you know, middle of the road events. And then the gray here is looking at atmospheric river precipitation, and the white is non-atmospheric river precipitation. And so what really stands out, probably to all of us, is this, you know, these extreme events, and most of these are going to be caused by atmospheric river precipitation, and they're becoming significantly more extreme, especially the most extreme. And so this is some of the things that the projections are indicating, that the most extreme atmospheric rivers have the potential to become a lot more extreme. And again, this has to do with the ability for the atmospheric rivers to hold more moisture. The wind component of atmospheric rivers is a lot more variable in the climate models, and it's not really clear how much that wind component will actually impact it. It has to do more with that thermodynamic feature of being able to hold more moisture in the atmosphere.